When we think of the word repentance today, there is a reflex among many to shy away from a declaration that you need to repent. It draws up images of the sawdust trail back in the Old West. We've probably seen video on television of these Old West stories where there were tent meetings and this wild preacher would be up at the front calling the audience to repent. And repent of their drunken ways, repent of their running around and follow Christ. In recent generations, there has been a rejection of that notion as being a part of the Christian gospel. A sense that repentance really should not be something that's sounded forth so much from the pulpits of our nation. Rather, unconditional love and welcoming of all people should be extended to all. I think of Paul Tillich, the great theologian at Union Seminary, who, in speaking of God's work in the world, considers that God is a God of love, and any notion that God is also a God of wrath is something that is incoherent. How can God at one time be a God of wrath, and then at another time a God of love? And how can these two work together? In his conception, God is unconditional love, and we misconceive God when we see him as wrathful. Rather, what we are doing is misunderstanding his love for us and making a wrong estimate of it. If we would only come to him, we would see that he is love, completely love, purely love. John Shelby Spong, an Episcopalian bishop, has written a book on how there is to be a new Christianity. And he is very upset with evangelistic notions and efforts by churches to send missionaries overseas to convert the heathen. For him, that is a very false notion. Indeed, it is hostile to true Christianity in his mind. To suggest that we can go to a different culture and call on that culture to repent of their sins and adopt Christian faith as opposed to their own particular faith is arrogant on our part, thinking that we alone know the truth. It is hateful of others because it commands them to repent in turn. And so John Shelby Spong rejects such evangelistic missionary endeavors. All men are to find their own way to God. And so you can see how these notions of God and of a new Christianity would reject a sense that we need to confront mankind with idolatry, their sin, their rebellion against the true God, and a command for them to repent and turn and change. Perhaps these modern theologians would consider that the message of repentance is one which sounded from every place throughout Scripture, beginning in the Old Covenant, but certainly at the very announcement of the gospel of Jesus Christ when John the Baptist stood before the people of his day. And what did he say? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's how the gospel accounts summarized John's prophetic message. Now, you might suggest that that was an Old Covenant message, but Jesus came right on his heels and said the same thing. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. At the heart of the Christian message is a challenge to people of our generation to repent, turn from sin, and to turn towards God. The Apostle Peter picks up that same theme. Nothing changes following the death and resurrection of Christ, this great demonstration of the love of God and his compassion upon sinners. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit comes down upon the church at Pentecost. And what does Peter do? But the first thing he says is, after reviewing God's work of redemption, he says, you must repent and believe the gospel. We cannot escape this fundamental aspect of the Christian faith, a call to repentance. And if we abandon that notion of repentance, then we are truly abandoning Christian faith. John Shelby Spong is really a pagan in Christian garments. He rejects true Christianity, and he proposes a different religion under the guise of Christian faith. The prophet Jeremiah was one who similarly called the people of his day to repentance. This was fundamental to the relationship between Israel of his day and to God. There needed to be a whole-souled, complete repentance for sin and a turning back to God in faithfulness and in love. And so this will be a message that, as we made the point last week, forms the core and heart of his call in this sermon, beginning with the second chapter. Going on through the end of the sixth chapter, Jeremiah calls the people of his day to repent, to return. Return, faithless Israel. Return, faithless children. Return, faithless sons. Jeremiah repeats that three times in these verses, beginning with chapter 3, verse 12, on through chapter 4, verse 1 or so. Return, faithless children. Return, faithless sons. The emphasis on this second section of this emphasis on repentance that we're considering this morning is the nature of that repentance should be a genuine repentance, a true repentance, and not merely an outward repentance. Last week, as we were reading from chapter 3, we began by noting that the prophecy that Jeremiah gave was in the days of Josiah the king. And we know that Josiah would be one who would institute great reforms throughout Israel. In fact, I made the point last time, and I didn't develop it as well as I would have hoped, that the Word of God is that which produces repentance in the hearts and minds of God's people. And Josiah is a point in case, or excuse me, a case in point. I'm dyslexic now, my speaking. Jeremiah is a case in point. For Josiah, boy. The law of God was found and discovered in the temple. And they read the law to Josiah the king, and when he heard the law read, probably the book of Deuteronomy, he rent his clothes, cast up dust and ashes, and repented because he knew they had sinned against God and they were facing his judgment. And his sorrow and grief did not stop there, but he went on to demonstrate true repentance by making a change as best as he could in his nation. And so he conducted a reform of the nation by destroying the temple, the pagan Baal worship all around. And so all their shrines and sanctuaries he would destroy. I was reading Michael Horton in his theology, Christian theology, in which he talks about the nature of repentance, and he distinguishes between a legal repentance and an evangelical repentance. And I would say at the start, I'm not comfortable with that distinction. It strikes me as something that's rooted more in a Lutheran point of view, a distinction between law and gospel. Is far too abstract, far too polarizing between the two. Josiah's repentance under the Old Covenant was not merely a legalized repentance provoked by the fear of God. It was certainly that. But it was clearly a true repentance which brought about a change in his life and in all that he could do before God and his people. And so he brought about the outward reforms that he was able to do. He could not change the hearts of the people, but he could certainly, as in his position as king, transform the nation and do what he could do in acts of obedience. And Josiah's obedience was commended by the Lord. in both Chronicles and Kings. So to merely suggest that there's a legal repentance merely based on law, I think misunderstands the turning to God and embracing God's mercy. That was what animated Josiah's reform, that God would have mercy on Israel because otherwise they faced his judgment. That being said, the people at large, while they may have gone along with Josiah's reforms and adopted some of the changes that he made, they themselves did not have a change of heart for themselves. And so for them, there was no true repentance. It was only outward. It was only ritualistic, if you will. It was from the top down, outward, not from within, going outward. And so now, Jeremiah, in addressing the people, says that if you return, you must return to me. In other words, make your repentance genuine and sincere, not merely outward and external. And he will emphasize that with the image of the circumcision of the heart. Circumcision was that covenantal rite whereby Israel demonstrated that they were the people of God in union with God. They were his servants. But it was not merely to be an outward ritual, it was also to be reflected in their hearts. And so in Deuteronomy, Moses often called the people to circumcise their hearts. Don't let this be merely an outward thing, but from the heart serve the Lord. That's evangelical repentance, true repentance, genuine from the heart. That's what God called for even under the law. Furthermore, here, Jeremiah renews that call for a thorough repentance that's not merely outward, going through the motions, but a genuine turning of the heart from sin to God and embracing Him with a living faith. So that will be at the heart of Jeremiah's message here. He called them to repentance and gave them motivations or incentives to repent, as we saw last time. All the many blessings that would accrue to them should they repent. They would be delivered from their alienation, their sin. They would be brought into the kingdom of God. They would be given godly shepherds who would feed them on the word of God. They would prosper in their ways, spiritually and materially. And God would establish them in Mount Zion as his children. These incentives were designed to motivate the people of God to repentance. And now what we find here, beginning with the 19th verse, is that Jeremiah continues this call to repentance and emphasizes the inward nature of that repentance. And he will even help them out by providing them, if you will, a liturgical form for repentance. This is what you must say. Sometimes in evangelistic meetings, you might hear the pastor or the preacher or the evangelist say, you need to pray the sinner's prayer with me. And then they go through a prayer and ask those who want to repent to repeat that prayer, a sinner's prayer. Well, this is something of what we have here, beginning with about the middle of the 22nd verse through the end of the chapter. The Lord, as it were, puts into words the kind of repentance he's expecting from his people, how they should repent. He's making it easy for them. This is what you need to be able to say from the heart. It's like Jesus in teaching his disciples to pray. One of the things that he teaches them to pray is, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. So repentance is given to us in the form of a model for repentance. Especially in that section, verse 22, B, if you will, through verse 25, there is a recognition that their behavior was in fact sinful. It was contrary to God's standards and outside of God's law. So their idolatry, their wickedness, is contrary to what God expected. And what God expects of them is to acknowledge that what they have done is sinful. and wrong. And furthermore, they should understand that their sins are what has brought on themselves all of the troubles of life that they are experiencing. Why is it that their herds and their flocks are depleted? Why is it that their children are suffering in different ways? How is it that these kinds of things are happening in their culture? Well, it's because you have sinned against God. You have engaged in idolatry. Does that not speak to us today in our American culture, where we see our nation is in debt to the tune of upwards of $200 trillion in terms of unfunded liabilities and debts? $200 trillion. I can't imagine how we got into such a debt. And there is simply no way that we can get out of it. It is beyond what we can do. How did we come to this point? The richest nation on earth has become absolutely in debt. Perhaps we should examine our relationship to God and how the nation as a whole has abandoned God and faith in Him. Repentance, turn from idols, faith in man apart from faith in God, faith in the kinds of gods that we create for ourselves, rather than in the true God who's revealed Himself in Scripture and in Jesus Christ. Repentance requires us to recognize our sin, recognize the consequences of our sin in our life, and then to see that we have sinned against the Lord. David put it this way, "Against thee and thee only have I sinned and done that which is evil in thy sight." David did not view his sin merely on human terms as an offense against those who were around him and all the consequences that that would bring to his life. His sin was an offense against God. And there needs to be this theocentric center to repentance. That my sin is a sin ultimately, finally, and most importantly, against God. The God who created me, the true God. Except I deal with my relationship with Him through repenting of my sins, and nothing else will get straightened out in my life. This is where it begins. So Jeremiah calls his people to repentance. It is to be a sincere repentance from the heart. This repentance was rooted in eternity past, where God set apart these people for Himself, and He pledged that they would be His own. There are different ways of interpreting the 19th verse. We have it here in the English Standard Version as more of a supposition. I thought that you would call me my father, and how I would have brought you into my kingdom. God expressing a wish and a desire and a hope for response from His people. I kind of think that the King James and New King James Version has this translated better, more forthrightly. It's God's statement as to what He has done. He has determined that these people would be His people, that they would be part of His kingdom. And He's declared that they will call Him my Father. Follow after Him. Repentance is rooted in eternity past and in God's sovereign purpose to bring a people to Himself. So how will God bring His people into His kingdom? How will God establish wicked people into His heavenly city? Well, it's through changing their hearts, bringing about repentance such that they cry out, "My Father! My Father!" That's the mark of a renewed heart and a renewed nature. That we now see God not as an enemy, as an opponent, as someone that we hate, but rather as the one we love, who is our Father, who provides and cares for us. And this is rooted in God's sovereign will, His sovereign purpose for us. In the New Testament, this theme is reflected in the words in the book of Acts, where I believe it's Paul, 1 Peter, and then Paul, notice that God is the one who grants repentance to Israel, or grants repentance to the Gentiles, brings them to himself. God is the one who makes the sovereign initiative in granting us repentance and enabling us to turn from our sins and to follow after him. So you have this rootedness of repentance in the sovereign action of God in the hearts of his people. But at the same time, you'll see as we get into chapter 4 that there is a call to us to respond to God's overture of grace, to respond to God's call to repentance with action. To, as Jeremiah says, break up the fallow ground and not sow in the thorns. Break up our hearts and sow in those things which bring true fruit and benefit. Repent toward the Lord and give yourself over to him. And don't continue on in the ways of wickedness that only produce thorns and thistles and so forth. Yield up your life to him. Allow his word to be planted in your heart and to bear fruit in this great transformation. Plow that ground in your heart. Bring about true repentance. And then there's that call once more to circumcise the heart. We must take responsibility for ourselves and produce the repentance that God requires. Turning over our sin and humbling ourselves before God and opening ourselves to the work of the Spirit within us. In conclusion, this call to repentance is a call that needs to be sounded forth today and should not be neglected by the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. It might offend some who come into our assembly that they're called to account for their sin, that they need to humble themselves before God, acknowledge their sin, repent and turn from it, and turn to him and ask for forgiveness. But this needs to be at the heart of the Christian gospel. And it is only that that will produce change in the lives of others. Long ago, Jim and Elizabeth Elliott understood this when they went to the Aka Indians in Ecuador and began a missionary effort there, preaching the gospel to those who had no connection with the outside world, who were entirely heathen and hostile to God. They came to them with the offer of grace and repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And you know the story, as Jim Elliot and others who were with them were attacked by the savages and killed, martyred for their faith. His wife and others would come back to that very same village and preach repentance. And a transformation would occur over time such that there would be the establishment of the Christian church in that community. Elizabeth Elliot passed away this summer, June 15th. She wrote a book called Through Gates of Splendor, where she spoke of her experiences and the experience of her husband in this regard. Repentance is not merely designed to humble our hearts and to cause us to grovel, if you will, before God. But it's the path to salvation. It's the way to receive life. And through repentance, we are ushered in to through the gates of splendor into glory itself. Repentance is the way to glory. And so abandon your idols. Continue to repent. The Christian must continue to repent throughout the course of life. And trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, who calls us to follow him through repentance and faith. Let's pray. Father, we pray that your Spirit would bless the ministry of your word, that you would grant us true repentance, that we would not go through the motions outwardly, but rather from the heart, turn from our sins, and rest in your provision of grace in Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray.